I welcome all of you to the fourth day of the lecture on series of lecture on computational fluid dynamics. The first 2 days were taken by Professor Puranik, where he had laid down the foundation for fluid mechanics before we get started with the CFD. I started what you can call as hardcore CFD with an introduction followed by grid generation, and then we had a lab session in the afternoon which consisted of problems in grid generation. There were basically two types of problem: algebraic grid generation and elliptic grid generation. In the elliptic, we had further two types of grids, one where it was a grid generation in an inclined plate, and the second we had a square plate with a circular hole, and there were different types of grid generation. And I had also mentioned, if you go through the problem set carefully, that O type, C type, H type can be applied to some specific problems. And towards the end, the last lecture yesterday was on computational heat conduction, where I had shown you that we use two levels of approximations, and we start from a control volume and end up with the same algebraic equation which you see in most of the CFD books, where they follow a mathematical approach of the derivation, where they start with the governing equation and take the volume integral, apply Gauss divergence theorem, and end up with the same algebraic equation. What I thought today is that let me start with whatever I had taught in the yesterday lecture. So I'll first start with grid generation. What is the key idea in grid generation? Because I could realize that yesterday many of you had certain confusion as far as grid generation is concerned, and especially this is a 5-day workshop. Finally, we'll get 10-day workshop. So whatever I'm delivering now, I have double the time to deliver in the it's the final thing. So I'm little fast, I understand, but I'm also trying to cut some syllabus based on the yesterday's feedback. Although initially I thought that I will try to cover almost 100%, but based on the yesterday's feedback, or I could see that I'm going little fast. So I had cut down some syllabus, but at least I'm trying to cover 80 to 90% of the total syllabus. It's really little fast, but I'm trying to be little slow to at least judge your understanding and then proceed. So I'll start today's lecture explaining the things which I had done. I'll take 2-3 pages to explain this. So I'll do it here so that I go slow and you understand each and everything clearly. So let us start with grid generation. What was the key idea in grid generation? Let us suppose you want to generate grid for flow across a car. So I'll take a car model. Let us suppose I take a 2D car model. Okay, let us suppose I represent the car as this is a simple car model, and let us suppose typically the height of this domain is 20. The upstream length, this we call as the upstream length, and this we call as the downstream length. This is the upstream length, this is the downstream length. So let us suppose this is 10 and this is 20. So total length is 30. I have to generate grid on this. We solve Navier-Stokes equation in this domain. This is which type of domain? This is physical domain, using finite volume method. Okay, note that this is a physical domain. So this is the job which you have to do. So the first thing, when you want to solve a CFD problem, you have to generate grid. So for that, first you will create a geometry. So this is the geometry and the domain which you will create. Okay. Now what I had taught yesterday is that now my job is to generate grid, and I had mentioned what is grid generation. Right now this domain has two boundaries. So the fluid is lying between the two boundaries. Which boundaries are that? Outer square and the inner solid surface. So there is inner boundary, there is an outer boundary, and the fluid is in between two. So I have two boundaries which are not connected, simply connected. Now grid generation means I have to divide into certain fixed number of grid points, and I said that in structured grid generation, analogous to horizontal series of horizontal and vertical line in Cartesian coordinate system, we have curvilinear grids here. And let us suppose here I want to have grids of 101 by 101, which will make it 10,201 grid points. Okay, so I want this many grid points. Let me tell you, the grid points which I mean here is the will be the intersection of the two family of lines. And the methodology which will be used, which we will be using, is we will use a finite difference method for grid generation. And in finite difference method, I mentioned that the grid points are defined at the intersection of the grid lines. So I will have two family of lines, xi and zeta. There will be 101 xi line, there are 101 zeta lines. I will start with a computational domain. My computational domain is, so this is my computational domain. Note that this I am using only for grid generation. It has nothing to do with final solution procedure. Final solution we will do it in this domain, note that. Okay. So in computational domain, this is only used for grid generation. We have xi zeta coordinate system and the size is 1 by 1. Okay. Now if I want 101 by 101 grid points, then I will draw equispaced horizontal and vertical lines. I would suggest that you can note down, because this is something which will help you in understanding later on. Okay, so we draw 101 equispaced horizontal, 101 equispaced vertical lines. Once we draw that, we get intersection, or you can also call those as grid points. Is that clear? Now the third step is, you can calculate delta xi as, what is the length in the xi direction? 1. If you draw equispaced, if the total line vertical lines are 101, then the spacing will be 100 spacings. Okay, so it will be 1 divided by 100, which is 0.01, and delta zeta will be 1 divided by 100 again. Is that clear? Once you know delta xi, delta zeta, you can write a very small program, because xi will vary in the x direction as 0, 0.01, 0.02 till 1. Okay. So you can determine, so fourth step will be determine xi and zeta at 10,201 points. Is that clear? Fourth step will be map the boundary of the computational domain to the boundary of the, you can write it also to the boundary of the physical domain. How do we do that? The physical domain is not simply connected. So we have to use branch cut. I may use a branch cut like this. So I will start maybe probably A, B as this. Then let us suppose I will go like this and come back and maybe my C is also here. Let me put it like this, A is at the top, B is at the top. So I go around, come back, C comes here back again, D comes here, then D to A goes like this. Okay, so I have to make a branch cut so that I connect the inner boundary, which is car surface, to the outer boundary, which is the outer boundary of the domain. So this is my branch cut, which I had shown by blinking line in the yesterday's slides, so that there is one-to-one correspondence between the computational domain and the boundary of the computational domain and boundary of the physical domain. Is that clear? Then, as a user, you have to make a decision how many number of points you want here. You don't know the dimension of the car, you know the dimension of the domain, and once you make a decision, the number of divisions which you will make, you can know the x and y coordinates. So once you map it properly, then you calculate x and y coordinates at the boundary of the physical domain and map it to boundary of computational domain. So let us suppose if I decide that between A and B I will have 4 points. So there will be one-to-one correspondence between the points here and there. Okay. So with this, you know x and y coordinates on the boundary. You know xi and zeta at all the I had mentioned here. You know xi and zeta after you have gone through the step at all the 10,201 points. You know xi and zeta. With this step, you know at the boundary points at least what is x and y, correct? Once you know, so what you know, xi and zeta at all points, and second thing, x and y at boundary points. This is what you know. So you let us suppose you use some black box. You give this as an input, and you what you get as an output is x and y at interior points. And what is this black box? This is an equation which you solve by finite difference method. What is this equation? It is definitely a PDE, but you may also need to use algebraic equation for clustering. Because to solve a PDE, you need the independent variable, which is xi and zeta at all the grid points, which is known here. And you need boundary conditions for the dependent variable, which is x and y. Note that this equation is such, PD is such that x and y are your unknowns and xi and zeta are your independent variables. X and y is dependent variable. Any question on this? Feel free to tell me if you don't understand this thing. If I had missed anything to explain, you can feel free to tell me. Okay. Now let me go to the please use mic here.
I'm sorry, but can you please elaborate on point number 4?
Here's a question on elaborating point number 4. What is point number 4? Map the boundary of the computational domain to the boundary of the physical domain. Actually, I wanted to write this. Map the boundary of the physical domain to the boundary of the computer. By mistake I wrote it, but I continued. But actually what I mean is that you start with the physical domain and you have to map. So this boundary of the cars, it should lie at the boundary of the computational domain. This boundary of the, in this physical domain we have inner boundary, outer boundary. both the boundaries should lie on the boundary of the computational domain. That is what I mean by mapping. And if we want both to lie, then they need to be simply connected, because this is simply connected. Computational domain boundary is simply connected. Whether that answers your question? That is what I mean by mapping. That we do. Yeah. By using a branch cut. Because in computational domain, boundary is simply connected. So to make the physical domain simply connected, I need to draw a branch cut. Okay, such as I said, A to B is this, B to C is complete rectangle, then C to D is this, then D to A is goes over the car surface.
Are there any rules for this procedure for branch cut, sir? Or is this our convenience?
Question is procedures for branch cut. I discussed different types of branch cut yesterday. Let us start from there. O type, C type, and H type. And I had mentioned that normally, depending upon the flow problems, we know we have some idea based on our understanding in fluid mechanics what will be the pattern of the streamline. And based on the pattern of the streamline, if your grid lines, one of the grid line, either xi or zeta, is along the streamline, then it is considered to be a good quality of grid. Okay, so this branch cut or which part of the domain I should map with which part, this is decided based on the family of line which is generated by O, C and H type. Okay. Any other question?
This can be done directly without mapping. Is it possible?
You can do unstructured grid also. For structured grid, this is widely used in all the software, this type of method. So you can come up with a new method, but this is commonly used and this is what 1 2 T.
And this inner boundary, that shape, geometry shape, how to get the equation for the car outer profile?
This is given. Actually, what happens is that whenever you want to do a CFD modeling, the first part is solid model. So those geometrical information is given by solid model. Yeah.
See, now Nikit, we have done mapping of both the boundaries of physical domain and the computational domain.
Yeah.
And for getting the interior mapping, we are going to use elliptic equation.
Correct.
So that means boundary condition, here we have got a Dirichlet boundary condition we are going to
use. Yes.
And in the last class yesterday problem, you told one is Newman boundary condition.
Yeah.
That is the case. Now, how do you know this boundary mapping? How will you do?
We start with it. Okay, let me first pose this question in simpler way. What he is asking is that right now I am saying that here I had written that we map the boundary. So we had written the second point, we know x and y at the boundary points. So this x and y, the way we are giving, it's a Dirichlet boundary condition, correct? So now he is asking that if I give this Dirichlet boundary condition, I will get a the grid lines will be non-orthogonal at the boundary. I had mentioned in the yesterday lecture and in the problem sets which we had given to you, in the second problem we had used that orthogonality condition at the boundary and we had shown you that the grid lines are indeed hitting normally at the inclined wall of that parallelogram shaped plate, correct? So his question is that if I am using Dirichlet boundary condition, how can I ensure the orthogonality, is it correct?
Yeah.
So the answer to this is that we start the first iteration with this Dirichlet boundary condition, but if we want to ensure orthogonality, there is a separate Neumann boundary condition which I had shown in the yesterday lecture slide. We have to implement that. So when you use a Neumann boundary condition, after each time step, the boundary point x and y will change. Intentionally I have avoided it due to there are more important things which I will do later on. In the final workshop, I will definitely include that. Okay, I will discuss that. Any other question?
Sir, while preparing this computational domain, now in this particular problem we have taken 101 number of horizontal and vertical lines. So is there any limit that, or how to decide this number?
Actually, let me tell you, CFD is not like any software. It needs some intelligence of the user. So this decision of the grid, the user has to decide. Because even if you use a software, it will ask you how many grid lines you want. It will not automatically say. Because what happens is that, and that is this something the software people or any developer cannot decide what will. There are certain things which a user has to decide. So this is one decision which you have to make based on your understanding that what is the complexity of the problem which you are solving. Whether you are solving, let us say, flow across a circular cylinder, or flow across a car, or flow across an aircraft. And based on that, you have you propose some domain size, and based on the domain size, you try to get an estimate, maybe from analytical fluid mechanics, that near to the wall, what should be the grid size. And based on that, you do some rough calculation, and may you come up with some grid numbers. So that way, I said, just I gave some number, 101 by first, I gave some number, but this may not be the right one. You may have to do a separate grid independent study, maybe 1000 by 1000 also you try. So there is a separate, I'll show you, I have a test problem tomorrow's in the afternoon lab session, we have a grid independence test problem also. So then you will understand that it's just we start with some grid number, and anyway we have to do grid independence study to make sure that our results are accurate enough.
Yes, because of by increasing the grid points,
yeah.
Is there any effect on your results?
It may have, it may not have. You have to run it then only. I cannot say that it will have or no. Yes or no is decided only if you run it. Because CFD is not so intelligent that it can say, yeah.
Can I just add?
Yeah, sure. Feel free.
See, the comment I would like to make is exactly what he was just talking about. Usually you have to do a grid independent study when you are doing these CFD simulations. And more often than not, I can tell you that the results will actually change when you are doing the grid independent study. So a priori, meaning beforehand you start, you may not have a good idea as to what good a grid you want. So you start with something as exactly what he said and keep on refining it until a certain level that you realize that the results are not really changing much. That's one part of it. Other part of it is what he had already pointed out, but I'll just reinforce that, which is you look at the physical situation. And let us say that you are trying to resolve a boundary layer situation, for example. So there is a flow going past a solid surface and you are actually interested in knowing the shear stress distribution on the surface. So in that case, what is important is that you want to capture the boundary layer profile correctly, which means that perhaps you will have to do a grid refinement close to the surface, and then away from the surface, it doesn't have to be as dense. So such things are obviously based on some experience, and that is why I think what he is saying is that right at the beginning you cannot really decide that this is what it is. It has to be an iterative process in some sense. Thanks.
Yeah, good. I'm happy that Professor Puranik is also pitching in to the questions, because I may give answer in some with some flavor, he may have a different flavor of. So I would suggest that you can keep interrupting whenever.
Sir, can you? Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Here, here. Sir, yeah. Can you suggest some good reference book for grid generation?
There are two books from which I had learned, so that is what I can suggest. One by Professor Sundarajan. There is a chapter by Professor Sundarajan in a book on computational fluid flow and heat transfer. This is an edited book. So various chapters are written by various faculties of different IITs. So in this book, Professor Sundarajan has written one chapter on grid generation, which I felt is very good. And there is a full book on full book on grid generation by Thompson, Watsey, and Martinez. If I'm wrong in the naming them, but Thompson is the first name. In fact, maybe you can get the soft copy of this book also. Is a full book on grid generation. Yeah.
Yes, actually that is right. Thompson and Warsi's book is considered to be the most standard book for grid generation. I don't remember, I'll find out and let you know. But also I'll add one more book to that list, and that is it's called Computational Fluid Dynamics for Engineers by Hoffman and Chiang. There is a really good the first volume, there are three volumes actually, 1, 2, and 3. The first volume, last chapter is on grid generation, and that's also very well written.
Sorry, I forgot to mention, I think actually some of the material which I had taken, I mean, so the equation, especially the algebraic grid, that I had learned from that book only.
Hoffman and Chiang, H-O-F-F-M-A-N, C-H-I-N-G. Unfortunately, perhaps that book is not easily available in India. But some libraries, I'm very sure, will have it.
Algebraic grids, whatever I'm teaching here, I had taken from equations from there. I agree.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so now, any other question?
Is there any restriction on the size of the computational domain in with respect to the physical domain?
So his question is size of the computational domain. So I think the answer is similar to what was the previous question. Previous question was grid independence. Now you are asking question on domain independence. So the answer is similar to what was there. Here also we take a domain size. We are not sure it is good enough. We need to increase the domain size. Let us say in this problem I started with 30 by 20. And then I increase it to 40 to 30. Length is 30 in this case and height is 20 for the physical domain. So to know that if I generate a result, whether this domain height, the upstream length, downstream length are good enough, if you run, you will not be sure. So you run one more case. With length you increase to 40, height you increase from 20 to 30. Then run it again, get the results and check how much difference is in the results. So if the difference is negligible, then you can say this is good enough. So this is what is called as domain size independent study.
Actually, I asked the size of the computational domain with respect to
computational
domain
size doesn't change. It will always be 1 by 1. Whatever may be the physical domain size, it is independent of that.
Do we have to do any Jacobian transformation when we do mapping?
Mapping or when you do the elliptic equation when you do.
Yeah.
At that time it comes. I think what your Jacobian you are saying is that from if you look into the book of J.D. Anderson, there is a Jacobian which he shows. But actually that in that what he does is that he doesn't solve in this physical domain, he solves in the computational domain. So that's why there it comes, Jacobians comes. But here what we are saying is that that is not commonly used nowadays. What is used is that once we get a grid here, forget about this computational domain. And this is our domain in which we solve.
Yes. Sir, I am tempted to ask one more question. It may be a premature question also.
No.
This governing equations we are going to solve on the physical domain now.
Yeah.
So, for example, we have got other systems. Say, for example, we have got XY Cartesian grid system.
Yeah.
And in this, we are going to have some two curvilinear systems.
Correct.
So, when you discretize, you are going to follow any, there is going to be any difference or it is going to be the same discretization technique?
Discretization technique, what I discussed in the class, finite difference method, yesterday lecture, same technique is used.
Even for curvilinear also, you can have east wall, west wall like that.
Okay.
But velocity, say if you take no u velocity,
It
will not be in the u direction. Now, say for example, suppose at east face, u velocity, then we are going to resolve into two.
Okay. So let me pose this question. What is asking is that if I have a curvilinear grid, so let us suppose I have a grid. One grid I am drawing, okay. Let us say this is one line, this is one line. So this grid, if you see, it is not aligned horizontally, vertically, or any standard coordinate system. So we need to come up with a finite volume formulation for this type of control volume. This is called as complex geometry formulation, which teach this to our regular course. But here in this course, I don't think I'll have time to teach this. Okay. But there is a formulation which is there. Okay, I'll stop here because I understand because right now we are having 50 people. In the final workshop, we may have around 1500 or 2000 people. And then there is a really, if people start asking questions, we don't want to discourage asking questions. But after a point, we have to make sure that we cover syllabus within time also. So let me just warn you, myself and Professor Pranik, we have taken note of it. And at some point of time, we will say that you can have further questions through Moodle. But in live interaction, we can do question answer till certain time only. Okay. But feel free to ask your questions. Let us leave the judgment to us when to stop. I hope Professor Puranik agrees with you. Okay. So let us go to the next thing. Now what I am thinking, yesterday Professor Rupesh Shah from NIT Surat had suggested that if I can show the discrete difference between the discretization of finite difference, finite volume, because people have certain confusion, what is the difference between finite difference and finite volume. And what I thought is that I take one example where finally whether you use a finite difference or finite volume, you end up with same algebraic equation. Okay, so with that idea in mind, I added one more thing, is that when I say finite volume, right now the way I had proposed, there are two types of finite volume. One is what I call as equation based, and second what I call as control volume based. So what I will do is that now I will show you the formulation of the discretization for finite difference, finite volume, and finite volume of two types. So let us start with that. Okay, discretization. We have three types of discretization techniques. Let me divide this paper into three parts. Here I will discuss finite difference method, here finite volume method governing equation based, and here finite volume method control volume based. I had taught you mostly in this way, and if you look into all the CFD books, they teach in this way, and the idea is we start with the governing equation. Which governing equation we use? Here I will take a governing equation which is two dimensional unsteady state heat conduction with no volumetric heat. Volumetric heat generation is very easy to discretize, so I am not discussing that. So what is unsteady state? Two dimensional rho Cp del capital T by del small t is equals to k del square T by del x square plus del square T by del y square. Let us discretize this using finite difference method and two different types of finite volume method. Okay, let us first start with the finite difference method. So in finite difference method, the way we discretize is, let us start with unsteady term. This we discretize as rho Cp. For del capital T by del small t, we use a forward difference scheme. So it becomes Ti comma j to the power n plus 1 minus Ti comma j to the power n divided by delta t. For the diffusion term, we discretize as k into Ti plus 1 comma j minus 2 Ti comma j plus Ti I minus 1 comma j divided by delta x square plus T I comma j plus 1 minus 2 T I comma j plus T I comma j minus 1 divided by delta y square. This is which type of scheme? Central. What is the order of accuracy? Second order. Okay. So this is the discretization. What I will do is that to show that this equation is same what we get in finite volume method, in finite volume method what we do volume integral. What is this equation? Right now the way this equation is per unit volume, governing equation is per unit volume. In finite difference method we do not do volume integral. So this final discretized equation is also per unit volume, correct? Now let us do one thing. To show that this finite difference equation is same as finite volume, let us multiply this discretized equation with volume. Okay. So multiplying by volume, what is the volume in 2D? Delta x delta y. So here I will get this will be multiplied by delta x, or let us say delta volume I would write. And when you multiply this by delta x delta y, what you will get? K into Ti plus 1 minus 2 Ti plus Ti minus 1 divided by delta x into delta y. Is this okay? Plus Tj plus 1 minus Ti comma j, sorry there is a 2 here, plus Ti comma j minus 1 divided by delta y into delta x. Is this okay? Why I am multiplying? Because in finite volume method we do volume integral. So to show that this equation is same as finite volume, I have multiplied by a volume, just to show that. However, in finite difference method, we solve this equation only. Anyway, the right hand side is 0, both sides we are multiplying by volume, so it does not matter, left side as well as right side. Okay, now let us go to finite volume method which I had taught in the previous lecture. What we do, we have used two levels of approximation. The idea which we use here is, we take the control volume, Cartesian control volume of length delta x delta y. This is the grid point P, this is the neighboring grid point E, this is the neighboring grid point W, there is a neighboring grid point N, and let us say this is the neighboring grid point S. We have defined the width of the control volume delta x, delta y. This distance we have defined as delta SE, I had defined, but it can be also called as delta XE. This can be called as delta XW. This can, the distance between the north and P can be delta Y north, and the south it can be delta Y south. So these are the geometrical parameters which will come into the expression. And the way we started is, let us first start with the unsteady term. The unsteady terms comes out to be, how do we do unsteady term? We start with a volume integral, rho Cp del capital T by del small t dv. And in this volume integral, density and specific heat, if you take, it is not function of temperature, then anyway it is uniform in the volume. So anyway, you can take this outside the integral. But this rate of change of temperature within the volume, we have done a second order approximation, and we have assumed that this is approximated as rho Cp del capital T by del small t at the centroid of the control volume into delta V P. Is this okay? So for this, we have to use the first order approximation. So for this, we have first level of approximation, and then we use second level of approximation to represent this as rho Cp Pp n plus 1 minus Pp n divided by delta T into delta Vp. Is this okay? What is the second level of approximation? Discrete representation of the temperature gradient at the centroid of the control volume. Okay, now let us look into the finite difference equation and this equation, whether they are same. They are exactly same. Okay, if you use the governing equation, finite volume based governing equation, let me tell you, the same idea is used here also. So this unsteady term treatment is what I discussed here, is the same here. There is no difference into that. There also it is done in this way only. Professor Puranik can correct me if I am wrong. Okay, so this is same, exactly same here. So unsteady term here comes out to be approximated as, unsteady term approximated as rho Cp Tp n plus 1 minus Tp n divided by delta T into volume. This is the same for unsteady term. So you can see that this term and this term, they are same. Okay, now let us go to the next term, diffusion term. How do we do here? diffusion term. What is the first level of approximation? We say that the heat flux, let us say Qx here, varies on this surface, but we want to represent as one point value. So we do surface averaging. So we say that we will represent it by centroid. This as centroid, this as centroid, this as centroid. So that way we represent this as, and then we say that Q, actually we take direction of heat transfer in the positive direction. So the way you do in undergraduate heat transfer course, Q is on the west face, Q is going inside, and east face it is coming out. And here we apply the conservation law. What is the conservation law? This represents the rate of change of internal energy. And on the right hand side, we have total heat gained by conduction. So when you talk of gained by conduction, gain is in minus out. So this west face and south face heat is going in. So we express it as, this is again approximation, Qw minus Qe into delta y. Delta y is the surface area of the vertical surface, plus Qn minus Qs into delta x. This is coming from first level of approximation, that Qx, Qx plus dx, Qy, Qy plus dy, it varies over the surface. So this is the surface averaging we do for the heat flux representation, one point representation. And what is the second level of approximation? Second level of approximation is discrete representation of Fourier law of heat conduction, where we represent Qws minus K Tp minus Tw divided by delta Xe, and Qes minus K Te minus Tp minus K Tp minus, sorry, Te minus Tp divided by delta Xw. Similarly, you can do for Qn and Qs. Now we substitute this to this equation. From the second level of approximation, whatever equation we have got in the first level of approximation, we substitute. Okay. Once you substitute, you will get this equation exactly. I am not showing you because it's just a substitution and checking it out. And I wanted to finish in this one page, let me be very frank. So you substitute this discrete representation of Fourier law of heat conduction into this equation, and you will see that you will get, you indeed get this equation. You can do the algebra on your own. It's just a substitution and checking it out. Okay. This is the control volume based. What is done in equation based, which you see in all the CFD books, what they do is that they start with vector form, because it's a mathematics based, so they start with a vector form K del square T, and they take the volume integral. Okay. Then they apply what they call as Gauss divergence theorem. Using Gauss divergence theorem, they convert the volume integral to surface integral. But then they convert, what happens? This is del T dot n. What is this n? It's the surface normal unit vector into ds. Actually, this can be converted into, actually this surface is simply connected surface which has consist of four surface. So this surface integral over all the four surface can be converted into two vertical and two horizontal surface. Now, as far as this unit vector n is concerned, these are surface outward normal. This normal we take as surface outward normal. Let us suppose I is the unit vector in the x direction and j is in the y direction. So which one is, so you will get a plus minus sign. Okay. So this will be in the plus I direction, this is minus I direction, this is plus j direction, and this is minus j direction. So if you substitute this, if you calculate del dot n, here you will get positive sign, here you will get negative sign. So what you get is equals to K del T by del x minus del T by del x on east face, sorry, plus del T by del x on east face minus del T by del x on west face. okay, plus k del t by del y on north face and del t by del y on south face. Sorry, I am not multiplying by area, there should be an area term here. Actually, this is also an approximation. Why this is an approximation? Because here I am introducing this east face center, west face center, north face center and south face center. And actually this has to be multiplied by surface area, and the surface area here is delta y and the surface area here is delta x. Is that clear? Note that when we go from here to here, there is an approximation. This surface variation, you can convert this into four different integral exactly, there is no issue into that, there is no approximation in that. But each of those four surface integral, when you convert into face center values, there is an approximation. Okay. And then this dt by dx e is approximated by using another piecewise linear approximation as t e minus t p divided by delta x e minus of t p minus t w divided by delta x w into delta y plus k into t n minus t p divided by delta y n minus of t p minus t s divided by delta y s into delta x. This again you can see, compare this to, actually this will, what will happen to this, this I can further write as minus k t e minus 2 t p plus t w divided by, if delta x e and delta, if you have a uniform grid point, this delta x e and delta x w is equals to delta x, and again this will come out to be t n minus 2 t p plus t s divided by delta y into delta x. Now compare this with this. Sorry, there is a plus sign here. Here there was a plus sign. There is a plus sign. Compare these two. They are exactly same. Okay, so with this example, you can get the difference between the finite difference and the two different types of finite volume method. So each one, each person can have its own perception. So you, one may feel that this finite volume method is good, it's short. I feel that this is easy to teach to the students. I may be wrong also. So whatever you feel, you make your own judgment. But these are the two different procedures.
Sir, in finite difference technique, you multiply it by delta v on both the sides. That is, I feel in order to compare with the finite element, finite control volume, you multiply it. Otherwise, it is not.
Yeah, it is not required. I am multiplying only to compare and show.
Yeah, compare and show. Sir, and the second thing is, third method is a special case of second method.
Yeah. It's same actually. If you look, it's. I am not using Gauss divergence theorem.
Yeah.
No, without. Yeah, sir, that is the only difference. Yeah.
Without Gauss divergence theorem, also we can integrate volume integral straight away. We have to do on the control volume.
Yeah.
We'll get.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that the second method is more general method. See, for example.
Yeah, it is more general. I agree. I perfectly agree. It's more general because when you go to complex geometry formulation, yeah, you can use a lot of mathematical concepts.
Yeah. And again.
But first course in CFD, I felt that this is. At least to get started the student, because you say that you are having CFD courses and the students are not taking because it's too mathematical. So it's just an alternative approach. Okay. It is up to you to decide. There is, I will not say this is good or this is bad or. Okay. So we have spent almost one hour before we are starting the next lecture. But I think this 1 hour interaction might have cleared a lot of doubt for you.